They have come to be known as the pioneers, that small number of Caribbean women and men who spearheaded the modern art movement in many of the countries of the region. These pathfinders, all of them gifted and productive artists, emerged in the 1930s and 1940s, a time of social upheaval throughout the region, where the demands of the organized working people were forcing radical changes on all fronts of the old colonial society. Prominent among these pioneers were Goldie White and Carl Brodhagen in Barbados, and in Guyana, Hubert Marchette and Rupert Burroughs. Enormously dedicated teachers, they established classes, organized exhibitions, founded art societies, and brought forward a generation of Caribbean painters and sculptors. As a result of their labors, art became a form of national expression. The Burroughs family migrated from Barbados to Guyana in 1903, taking with them the two-month-old Edward Rupert. The Barbadian-born Burroughs lived in Guyana until his death in 1966.
Our formal training was really on the Burroughs in the Working People's Art Class, 1949. When I joined, I was, I think, about 14 years old, and I joined that class. And I was happy to join it because here I found a community of people who were doing the things. It was unbelievable. Here you had a room full of people who were doing the things that I like to do. My first meeting with Burroughs was an evening because the classes were held on Thursday evenings at the auditorium in Charlotte Street, now a derelict building. And I went to him and I said I would like to join this class. This was sort of 7 o'clock the evening. Had to have special dispensation from my father to go. And he said, well, you know, in his usual very authoritative self, you know, this is not a class for little children. As you can see, these are all grown-up people. He must have seen the expression in my face. Because he said, well, if you look across there, there are a couple of youngsters over there. Perhaps you can go and join with them and do something. So I went with these fellows. There were just about three of us. And so we had our own little junior community going there. Burroughs taught us, he was very free with his knowledge, theoretical and practical. We did paintings, we did pastel drawings, pencil drawings. We did a scraper board, or sometimes they call it illustration board, scraper board techniques. We did lino prints, printmaking. We did wood carving, modeling in cement, modeling in clay. We did all the work. So that when I did get to university in 1962, at the end of the first year, I wanted to come return back to Ghana because I said, yeah, I'm not learning anything in this place.
Among Burroughs's contemporaries was his boyhood friend, who later became his colleague, Hubert Marchette.
He had a good supply of books, and we used to exchange. And then I used to see him painting. I used to do a little, but not to the extent that he did. And he was very serious about it because he would take pieces of colored paper, boil them and make colors for his paintings. He was so enthusiastic that he started a class of his own, which he called the Working People's Art Class.
The Working People's Art Class was quite a phenomenon, actually. I think unique to the Caribbean, because Burroughs was a member of the Guyanese art group, which functioned quite strongly in the 40s. And went into decline in the late 40s. Burroughs felt that art belong to the masses as well, that they should not be excluded from this activity. And seeing that, they felt that perhaps they could not approach the Guyanese art group. That was something which they felt, but in effect, they were not excluded from that. Because the Guyanese art group, the early members of that group were actual artisans. They were sign painters, tailors, and people like that. But over a period of time, they were replaced by the sort of middle class element. So Burroughs went out, literally went out into the streets and got stevedores and baker shop hands and workers to join this group. He was also well read in English social history, English history and literature, and had a great feeling for the William Morris and what he stood for. And so the whole, the ethos behind the Working People's Art Class was based on the Morris movement in Britain. I think at the time when he created that class and named it the Working People's Art Class, immediately he came to the attention of the colonial police.
There was a friendly spirit among all the artists, and we got on well together. We were like all, you know, a good lot of, like a family. We lived together as a family, and we were always visiting each other and chatting on paintings and whatnot. And you were a very happy crowd. We lived very happily. I think I see a different spirit today. The artists are much more isolated than they used to be in my time.
The sense of a kind of unity amongst members, a sharing in spiritual ideals, even though that sharing would not have been verbalized, it was certainly there, and it extended. It was there within the Working People's Art Class, as Machette said that he found this kind of brotherhood, sisterhood thing in the Guyanese art group. It did exist in the Working People's Art Class as well. When I look back over the years, I realize that in a sense, the Working People's Art Class, we were so much turned into ourselves with what we were doing. We paid very little attention to the social struggle. That did not seem to mean much to us. Even though we knew Burroughs himself was asked by Cherry Jagan and Forbes Burnham in the early days of the PPP to run in the general elections in Newtown. And he refused because he felt that his energies had to be devoted to the class, because he was a very fine speaker.
Landscapes were preeminent in the exhibitions. Without any attempt at bringing in any foreign element, we just made a true copy of what we saw, a faithful copy of what we saw, put it in color, and exhibited at the exhibition. There were a few of us who wanted to do portraits. I particularly was very, very fond of portraits. Well, there were two things against it. First is that people never paid for portraits. He never made money. While the landscapes were selling like hotcakes, so we went all out for landscapes, got them sold, you know. I'm very fond of using the palette knife because I like the effect it gives, the semblance of nature, the veins on the tree and the surfaces you get. on various objects.
A familiar figure in theater and art circles in Georgetown, where she lived for 13 years, and with the experience of the British Guiana Arts and Crafts Society behind her, Goldie White returned to her native Barbados in 1943. Back on the island, it did not take her long to busy herself in various theater activities and in the organization of the Barbados Arts and Crafts Society, which was established in 1944. Together with colleagues she had gathered around her, she held classes in drawing, painting, and design. She also taught art for many years at Codrington High School. Goldie White died in 1977. Carl Brodhagen was born in Guyana in 1909 and taken to Barbados, where he has lived ever since.
Well, I came to Barbados in 1925. I spent my 15th birthday here. In the beginning, I found myself very strange for so many reasons. Firstly, I'm from a cosmopolitan country that has different races. You know, I went to school not only with different races, but I went to school what they call quad, male and female. And the situation here was rather barren to me, because I only saw black people and some white people. And so it took me a time really to fit myself in. And of course, we didn't know anybody here particularly, so we were rather reserved and kept to ourselves and so on. And of course, that this strata, the society thing, business here was very, very strong. The levels of, and particularly in art, because there were those middle and upper middle who were able to go to art schools, and the other people like craftsmen and people like me, and Ivan Payne and some of the others that, you know, we were struggling along at the time. Goldie White. Well, you know, she had done quite a lot in this place. You know, she even in Guyana, she had started some movement there. And when she moved back here, she did quite a lot. As a matter of fact, she's who influenced the in 44, when we start the Art and Craft Society, she was the person, the mover in that. You know, I think she was our first president or whatever, but she was the person to do that. So she did quite a lot. And her work, we thought, was a very high standard, very, very high standard. And, Hamilton, Aileen Hamilton, she too, she was another of that group, which studied abroad. And Harold Connell, all of those are people of the higher society here that had studied abroad at art school. Aileen Hamilton, Connell, and we had MacLeod. He was a Barbadian that lived abroad for many years and came back, and he was very popular. The teachers were more promoted in art because people like Mrs. White and Aileen Hamilton, and they did some kind of teaching on Saturday classes. They had a Saturday classes where some school teachers went to these classes. Briggs Clark was one that went to these classes. These school teachers were ahead, but craftspeople like me, a tailor and pipe and pen, a cabinet maker, you know, we were a little low down in many ways. But Payne had something in me because he's what you call a natural naive or whatever you want, you know, intuitive or whatever. But you see, my approach was realistic. But Payne, they thought more of what Payne was doing. I couldn't sell anything. These days people are saying that I'm mean, I wouldn't sell anything and so on. I'm not a customer selling anything. And at this stage, I never thought art in Barbados would be at this stage. Not only so many people painting, but people appreciating what you're doing. Yeah, I was interested in Michaelis, firstly because he lent himself, I thought, very well to sculpture. But he was an important person in the community. He was a public benefactor because from very early when he came back, he noticed that the Barbadians need assistance, the poorer Barbadians. And he, by the way, we had vestries at that time in this. They have different vestries in different parishes and so on. And he was a leading minister in one of the vestries. So he provided clothes for children to go to school. He had a soup, what you call soup kitchen, to feed people. He fed people. And all of this he did from his dye works. He dyed clothes, as I said. Anything that he would dye, he had his place in Chapel Street. And I said before that his motto was, I live to die and die to live. But as I said, two persons was Reverend Lawrence and him. I wanted him because I thought he lent himself to sculpture, the form. You know, sculpture is very sensuous and you want something to work on and the shape and everything. That prominence of mouth and all like that. And the head, the shape. All of that, you could see that he used, several people have that, but his was very, very outstanding. And as I said, his voice, he was so powerful. If you were here, you must know if you were passing the road, you know he's in here, because he laughed a lot, and a really big laugh. I want to say, in the 60s, I had quite a lot of girls coming from Queen's College to pose for me, to draw. I drew their heads. I have a lot of drawings of them. I drew and drew and drew. She was one that came, but she had some of the qualities I liked so much. She had a long neck, and of course her cheeks and lips. So I made quite a lot of drawings of her. This is a creative piece more so. I use her features, but I did things that I usually do to work. I don't do a work really straightforward. Seldom I do. I mean, I've done one of the governor's wife, and I was told it was the worst possible thing I did, because she didn't hold my hand, and that was all, because all the julap she wanted taken out and the whole thing. However, getting back to this, I lengthened her neck a little more. She has a long neck. I lengthened her neck. Because I thought that I could have a representative of Nefertiti using her. Her name is Bernadine, and this piece is called Nefertine. Nefertine. And I consider it a very successful piece, because in sculpture, you should at least have three acceptable views. If you can't get the minimum of three acceptable views, good views of the subject, you make a relief. And with this, I find, man, it has something everywhere. I first did her as Bernadine, a similar thing. Now, I must tell you, I put a ice cream box to do the hair, keep it up. She had the length of hair, but to keep it up, I actually move it out, put a box, and put it to keep it up. Not in this. In the first one I made, using her real hair. But as I said, the length of neck, it gives a feeling of Nefertiti, which is thought to be one of the most famous portraits. But I'm saying this has, look at that view. You have a side view and you have a front view. But the back view is tremendous, man. Look at it. Look at the feeling of movement upward. You can't help feeling going up all the time. And with having the hair like that, so too, the whole thing goes up. I visited Trinidad on several occasions, conducting classes for the art society at that time. And while I was there, I wanted to do a Chinese girl. I went to Margaret White. She's who first invited me to go to Trinidad to run classes. And I did some very successful classes there. And on this occasion, I told her I wanted to do a Chinese girl because all in Barbados, I've never had a chance to do Chinese or an East Indian or so. And I wanted to think. And she said, well, I'll get somebody for you. And this is Anna Singh. She was an art student, so she knew her. She was about to go abroad to do art as well. And I did this this canvas board was given to me by Margaret White. And I painted her in Margaret's studio. So I posed her front like that. And I just worked. You notice the scheme is a cream scheme where the color and the background is only a matter of tonal values and so on. So I did that. But my great enjoyment is the hands. You know, I like the hands because the stories of that day, the Chinese pictures, you know, with Anna Wong and the Dragon Lady and things like that and so on. So when I roughed out, well, hands, I like hands very much. And when I rubbed out the hands, it had this clawing kind of thing. And I liked it. And as if you see, there's more painting in the thing. I bring up the face. I would have done more to the face and probably matched the face with the hands, the color. You notice the color is not the face color, it's not anything like that. But I got so excited, I didn't worry about the face particularly. I just went and do all the work in the hands and arms. I like people. You know, I like people. And there's such a wonderful variety of expressions and shapes and proportions. I don't know how I should explain it, but I've always been that way. I always like people. I attribute it probably to, growing up with mix. You must know people when you're seeing such a variety of people, and you will have to observe them. They're different shapes, expressions, and all like that. And I suppose that is from my early growing up in Guyana, is responsible for that thing. And I particularly like certain features that I think lend itself better to sculpture. You know, lips, a certain fullness and shape. Cheeks, she has very nice cheekbones, that she really has lovely cheeks. And nearly always, the length of neck is an attraction. And the structure, the bone, eyes particularly. I am very fascinated by eyes, I've always been. And a lot of my early work was very frontal. And there was a criticism, I think this is the same Mrs. White criticized, and said, why you put people facing and a bit staring and all like that. But my fascination was for the eye, not so much to do with the overall happening, you know. And I like eyes, and I find, as I say so often, I find the slant in women's eyes, a lot have slants, especially certain very dark women have a slant. The eyes are slanted. And I mean, I'm saying this over and over. And it is not the Oriental thing at all. It's not the Chinese puff. The Chinese have more a puff than a slant, you know, but people don't observe it. You don't see a lid, you see a puff, and the puff gives the feeling. And you notice whenever you want to make eyes look slanted, you deliberately slant them. But the Chinese are puff. And I find that it is different in the black people I have seen that have the slant. But I am very, very fascinated by that. And lips, I find lips, you know, A lot of black people are afraid of their lips, about fullness and all of that. But I mean, a thin lip look very deceitful, and I find it so, you know, I can't help saying that. You don't see anything, you know. And since sculpture is a sensuous thing, you want, I mean, I enjoy just filling these lips so and doing that. And working over cheekbone, man, you're working over that form. And down the neck, this column, this down the mastoid muscle here, and all of that thing, you know, it's a sensation you get in all the time, you know. It isn't just a plain, straightforward thing. And then you come to the intricacies and the design of the hair. The hair is very beautifully designed, you know. I had promised one time to just do hairs. As a matter of fact, you could know a person by his hair. Although hairs could be in a general way, a certain fellow has a peculiar kind of hair. The general structures are the same thing, the inner curve, the atrium in here, and that, and the whole thing. But airs, this now, when you come to airs, now airs is designing. It's a different thing, feeling from the sensuous thing of the other thing. The poise is one of the things. She has very nice poise. She has a natural inclination to keep her head up, which I would probably want to do with her head so you could see the features. But she really, this is something not only characteristic, but it's very nice. You could see that, how the head goes there. And I mean, I love hair. I often thought my mother had tresses, you know. She was a short woman, and she was part half Portuguese. And my mother's hair was all the way down. And I've always liked hair. I've always done things, designs with hair.
That making another bone from your mild, talkative hands is making death, I know. All I, you have done sinks in the past and takes shape not with breath, singing our memory like the sun.